Much has kind of already motivated the idea of optimization bias and specified many results relating to it. In my talk, I'm hoping to reiterate some of his points. Actually, some of the results are reiteration of the results he already presented, and also give some new results, which was not in Matthew's talk. And since everyone has already asked the questions to Matthew, so I'm hoping that it will go much more smoothly. All right. So this is joint work with collaborators and friends from TTI and Technion and USC, including Jason and Nati, who are here, and probably Blake also, but never mind. Okay. Okay, just you guys. All right. So the motivating goal for this line of work is to understand understand learning in deep neural networks. Specifically, we want to understand what is the true inductive bias that drives generalization in deep learning, which is observed in practice. So for our talk, deep neural networks are simply a specific way of parameterizing a prediction function that maps inputs to some labels. And throughout the talk, we'll be denoting the parameters of a prediction function using W. And the specific form in which neural networks work is essentially create a refinement of inputs leading up to the final prediction, which is close to the output. And we'll visit the details as and when necessary. And a winning recipe for the empirical success of deep learning has arisen from a combination of training very large neural networks on large-scale data sets comprising of input-output pairs. A key component of the learning process involves simply a loss minimization over the observed examples using algorithms like simple variants of gradient descent or stochastic gradient descent. While neural networks have enjoyed a lot of empirical success, there are many many aspects of it are not understood theoretically. One of the aspects which is pretty well known, but I will not be touching upon, is the fact that the optimization objective that arises out of minimizing the training loss over the networks is non-convex and hard in the worst case. As a consequence, gradient descent variants need not minimize the objective in general. But in practice, though, we always observe that neural networks trained on real data sets typically end up giving you zero error solutions, which are global minimizers of the problem. An even more mysterious aspect is that the neural networks used in practice are extremely large capacity, and the number of parameters typically used in these networks are much larger than the number of examples. As a consequence, the optimization objective has multiple global minimizers that perfectly fit the data. If optimizing the training loss was our main objective, this is not an issue, because any global minimizer is as good as any other global minimizer. But what we really care about is how well I do on a new example. And from that perspective, this optimization problem becomes ill-posed. And in fact, we can show that most minimizers of the objective will overfit or memorize the data and perform poorly on test data set. And in practice, though, the special minimizers returned by gradient descent or stochastic gradient descent-like algorithms have remarkably good performance on new example. These observations suggest that the algorithms used in the optimization, like gradient descent or its variants, are key to learning good models rather than the optimization objective itself. And one of the main things we'll be building towards is like to build a theoretical understanding of why do neural networks trained with variants of gradient descent perform well in practice. And today we'll be looking at this aspect from looking at understanding this phenomenon in much simpler models, including linear models and linear networks. Okay, so let's look at this phenomenon in a much simpler problem, that of matrix completion. So matrix completion, we have a ground truth matrix W star. We observe some of the entries of the matrix, and the goal is to impute the missing entries. And a pedagogical example of this problem is recommender systems, which was popularized by the Netflix challenge, where a common assumption is that the ground truth matrix is somewhat low rank. So we want to estimate a low rank matrix which fills in the missing entries. So there's been a ton of work on this area, including many of my own earlier work. But our goal today is not to understand how to do low rank matrix factorization, but to use it to illustrate a different point. So in particular, if you just look at the problem itself, we want to estimate a matrix and we have some observations. A natural objective is to just minimize the loss over the observations. But at least for matrix completion, this loss is a completely trivial problem. What we are essentially doing is filling in the observed entries with the observed entries. And any imputations of the matrix is a global minimizer of the problem. But, so in some sense, this is a completely nonsensical problem to solve. But we'll insist on solving this problem in a different variation, where instead of optimizing over W, we'll optimize over, we'll represent W as product of two matrices U and V and optimize over U and V. This formulation is indeed used in practice in matrix completion, but typically to, because this is a natural way to, you can enforce the low rank constraint. In other words, you can restrict the dimensions of U and V, and that will give you a low rank constraint problem, although it's a non-convex problem. There has been studies on when it converges to global minimizers. But today we are not going to restrict the rank, but rather do the same optimization over full dimensional U and V. So we have exactly equivalent problem. So we have not changed anything. There is no explicit rank constraints or any other form of regularization. These two are exact problems, just under different parameterizations. As a consequence, the second problem has the same trivial minimizers as the first problem. So there's nothing new. It's as nonsensical to solve this problem as the first problem. But we are going to see what happens when we do solve this problem using gradient descent. And actually, like, this matrix completion problem is a special case of general matrix estimation from linear measurements. You can think of a similarly underdetermined least squares problem where the parameters we are estimating are matrix parameters. Again, if the number of observations is less than the number of parameters we are estimating, this is like a completely underdetermined problem. But we are going to solve this general problem using a factorized approach. And in particular, this is a special case in many, this is a setting for many tasks, including multitask learning, matrix sensing, matrix completion. And in the factorized form, you can also think of it as a two-layer network with linear activations and without a bottleneck layer, right? Where the hidden layer has enough dimensionality. And what we will be observing is like whether gradient descent, doing gradient descent on these two equivalent objectives gives us different different answers, even though like they're essentially solving the same problem. And this is some simulated data set just for illustration purposes, where training error is the error on the observed entries or like the observations, and test error is the error on new examples. So when we run gradient descent on these two algorithms, these two objectives, what we find is that both the algorithms are doing the job of optimizing the objective correctly. So both of them give us zero training error solution. But what is surprising is that when we run gradient descent on the factorized objective, we get a solution which is which also has good test error. So in some sense, it's a better minimizer than the minimizer returned by gradient descent on L of W, at least for this problem. And even more surprisingly, instead of doing exact line search for the step size, if I do small step sizes, you get to an even better solution. Right? So what's happening here? We have three algorithms, all solving the same objective, so same problem, but different parameterizations and different hyperparameter choices, like step sizes. With these differences, you already end up with different solutions for the same optimization problem. And especially the solution with small step size or when doing gradient descent on the factorized space gives us something very special, and we want to understand what the special solution is. So this was work from a while back, and when we investigated it empirically, we found in this experiment and many other experiments that the solution we converge to is actually like the minimum nuclear norm solution. So for those of you who are not familiar with nuclear norm, it's just a norm over the matrix values, which is known to be a relaxation of rank constraint. And many of the early work actually relate how minimizing the nuclear norm leads to generalization and recovery in low rank problems. So this is nice. So we kind of have a bunch of empirical observations on this topic. And we can formalize it more formally, where as a more concrete conjecture, where we want to study when gradient descent on the factor space converges to a minimum nuclear norm solution. And in the experiments, we observe that this happens when the initialization is going to zero and the step sizes are going to are very small. And we can formalize it more mathematically. And this conjecture with a bit more mathematical assumptions was proved for a very special case of commutative measurements in our earlier work, but a later work actually generalized it to much more common forms of random measurement matrices. And yesterday, Ankur told me that him and his student have a proof of this conjecture for more general matrices, so we can look out for the paper later. So at this point, let's take a step back. So I have introduced the problem of matrix completion, where I knew that I wanted to solve a low-rank problem. And even though we have a ton of ways to solve actually low-rank problems, I insisted on solving it in this over-parameterized regime. So this seems like an artificially created problem for which I'm trying to prove a theorem. But the reason we wanted to go through this exercise is to actually understand that this is indeed the phenomenon which is commonly observed in training of neural networks too. So if you look at standard, some of the neural networks used in some of the standard tasks, the number of parameters which used for training is much, much larger magnitude than the number of examples. And often the parameterization is like 10 or more times larger than the number of examples. And like with matrix completion, most of the minimizers of these objectives will not perform well on good new data set. And in spite of that, like the solutions returned by gradient descent like algorithms actually do well on in practice. Okay. And so this suggests that the optimization plays an important role in learning beyond reaching a global minimizer of the objective. In particular, if you have an overdetermined problem with many minimizers, you can imagine, as shown in the cartoon picture here, you can imagine taking different optimization paths or different optimization updates lead us to different minimizers. And what this also suggests is like changing the algorithm or changing the hyperparameter choices will also affect how well you generalize to new example and not just how well you optimize the objective itself. And this has been more concretely and more extensively studied in many empirical experiments before us, including the one with student Benham from TTI. So here it's like just two algorithms. So one is stochastic gradient descent and another is a variant of stochastic gradient descent. I won't go into what the variant is. But we see that both algorithms optimize the training loss over the neural networks at about the same rate, and both give us zero training error. But the solutions they converge to are different. As a consequence, the test error returned by the models from these algorithms are actually very different. Similar observations have also been studied in many other empirical studies, including understanding the size of mini batch used in stochastic gradient descent, understanding the effect of adaptivity, and many more aspects of this. And we already saw such a result in our talk so far, and that was in the matrix completion case, where again we observed the same phenomenon. We have same objective, multiple algorithms, different algorithms leading to different solutions, and some of them generalize better. So again, this brings us to the point that the algorithms rather than the objective itself is central to learning good models in the modern practice of deep learning, okay? So as a one slide summary of the thing we are building towards, like, so the punchline is that the optimization algorithms introduce an implicit form of inductive bias into learning, and understanding the nature of this bias is important to understand how and why we learn neural networks. And this also could potentially lead to many implications to our practice. Specifically, it can lead to better optimization algorithms or modifications or heuristics, which are adapted for faster computation and better generalization. It could also inspire new modeling tools, like including regularization and architecture design. So I'll briefly talk about three results, like, and mainly focus on the second one. So the first, I'll just motivate essentially like the optimization and binary classification for which the Mathus already gave an answer. I'm just going to reiterate the solution. And then we'll spend much of my time on understanding the optimization bias in linear networks. And finally, try to connect these pictures, these individual pictures, through a theme of understanding the optimization bias in terms of optimization geometry. So going to optimization bias in binary classification, so we are gonna consider a separable data sets where we have some positive labels and negative labels which are separable by a linear classifier. And we are gonna learn a linear classifier in this problem using logistic loss as our loss function. So this is a standard logistic regression setting. And so for linearly separable data set, due to the nature of this objective, we can easily check that there are no finite minimizers of this objective. In other words, like as long as I find a separator, like the logistic loss can be reduced by simply increasing the norm of the separator. Okay? So as a consequence, there is no finite minimizer of this objective. So if I run gradient descent on this objective, actually like the solutions will never converge. They'll diverge in norm. Right? But what we really care about is not exactly like the value of the iterates itself, but actually like the direction of the iterates, because that's what determines what the classifier is. We only care about the signs which the predictor is predicting for different data points. So essentially, different separating hyperplanes are different classifiers. For example, any of these separating hyperplanes, you can take the norm to infinity, and that will be a global minimizer of the objective. So the main question is, like, which classifier or direction does gradient descent converge in? And we already know the answer, because Matthews gave us the answer, and the answer happens to be the maximum margin separator. And maximum margin, like, if you're not familiar, it's essentially a separator which maximizes the distance to the closest margin, where the distance is measured in terms of L2 norm. So that's why it's a Euclidean max margin or L2 max margin. Okay? And the interesting thing about this result is, like, this is independent of the step size we used in gradient descent and also, like, initialization. And at least, like, from the perspective, intuitively we can understand this, because what we are effectively doing using gradient descent is, like, going to a very, very distant place. Like, the norm of the W of T actually goes to infinity. So from an infinite distance, like, all initializations and all step sizes start looking infinitesimal. So roughly, like, that's how I intuitively understand why we get characterizations which are independent of step size and initialization. And this is, like, so this work, so we have an extension of this work where, although we say that the final solution we converge to is independent of the step size, like, using an adaptive step sizes, like, can still increase the speed at which you converge to the final solution. Right? And this kind of heuristic has also been tried in, like, actual neural networks, and there are some preliminary results which show that, like, it could be a valid heuristic to use. So this work so the results of this work actually closely follow one of Matthews's much earlier work on, where he showed that, like, when doing boosting over linearly separable data sets, you actually converge to a solution which is L1 max margin solution. So L1 max margin solution is actually, like, it's essentially a separating hyperplane which maximizes the distance to the closest point in L1 norm. And along with this work, in a parallel work, Matthews also removed many of the constraints in this problem, like, including extending it to like data sets where there is no strict separability. And so a couple of other work also extended it, the same result, to stochastic gradient descent rather than gradient descent itself. Any questions? Okay. Right, so usually in practice, they cut the step size, but what we found, at least for this problem and linear networks, is essentially you should increase the step size, and increasing the step size seems to lead to faster convergence. So that needs a bit more of empirical exploration to actually translate it into a more formal answer for what is the right thing to do in neural networks. But yeah, at least for linear networks, we can show that, like, increasing a step size is actually a better thing to do, at least to get to the same convergence, to get to max margin problem. Okay, so just to give a high-level idea of why this might be happening, like, Matthews actually gave a proof idea. This is, like, another way to think about the same thing. So if you write down the gradient update, you can see that the gradients are always spanned by the data set, and it's in the positive span of the data set. Like, so this is, like, the gradients for exponential loss, which behaves very similar to logistic loss. I won't go into the details of that. But if you look at the form of the gradient update, you can see that, like, it's spanned by the data set, and it's in the positive span of the data set. And moreover, the coefficients corresponding to each data set is largest for the points which are closest to the decision boundary. So as a consequence, when I keep accumulating these gradients, so the effect of the components from the closest points will start dominating. So when I accumulate these points and then eventually normalize, what ends up happening is essentially, like, the normalized vector will be spanned by the data set, but just the support vectors, because that will be the dominant component. And that essentially gives us that's a sufficient condition to show that you converge to a maximum L2 margin solution. So that's kind of a rough overview of what happens in logistic regression. But we want to build this theory towards more complicated models like neural networks, right? So what about neural networks? We don't have an answer for neural networks, but we have a good understanding of what's happening in linear networks. So linear networks you can think of as a multi-layer compositional network, where in each layer there is a linear transformation. So we have an input x, and then we do a linear transformation to get the next input, and so on, until the last but one layer, at which point you take a linear combination to give us the final solution. Okay? So now you can think of representing each of the linear transformation in each layers using WL. In layer L, it's WL. Different constraints on Ws, the individual matrices W, will lead to different architectures. For example, in a fully connected network, there is no constraint on W. Each of these W matrices can be full dimensional. And I'm also considering only the cases where there are no bottleneck layers. All the layers have enough width so that there is enough over parameterization. And another constraint we can think of, which we'll be looking at, is convolutional networks, where each individual linear function is restricted to be a valid convolutional operator. Okay, and we'll be comparing what happens when I run gradient descent on these networks. So specifically, we'll be looking at exponential loss, which again, as I said, behaves very similar to logistic loss. And so first thing we notice is like every such network, irrespective of the constraints I put on the architecture, all of them represent only linear classifiers. So for every value of the weight vector on the network architecture, I can assign a beta W, which is like a linear classification boundary, so that the function computed by this network is simply a linear function of x. Okay? So you can think of different architectures as just different parameterizations of the same optimization problem, which is similar to the logistic regression problem we previously saw. And the question is, like, what classifiers does gradient descent on different architectures learn? And are they going to be different even though the problem is the same? Okay. So the first network is like the fully connected network. And here we can show that for any depth, irrespective of the depth, the gradient descent again converges to the Euclidean max margin solution. So this is essentially like the same solution as returned by logistic regression. And this was also like studied in parallel by Matos, and as he mentioned in his result, like the convergence to max margin happens through an alignment process where each of the layers actually align the matrices which they compute. So what we started off saying that these different parameterizations could lead to different solutions, but here we have that if we have fully connected networks, all solutions actually converge to the same problem as logistic regression. So I must say that like this result was proven under a lot of assumptions. I'll revisit the assumptions in a bit. And Matos's work removed many of the assumptions we made in our work. And so this result was also, there is also an extension of this result showing the rate of convergence and like extension to non-exponential loss. Exponential tail, but not exponential loss. So, but what happens for convolutional networks? So here again, we have a linear model. This again eventually predicts, learns only a linear network. But here we observe that the solution we get is very different from what we get from fully connected networks. Specifically, to first put it in English, what gradient descent does is implicitly introduces a bias that promotes sparsity in the frequency component. So I have input x, and I eventually learn a predictor beta w. So what gradient descent ends up doing is to learn a beta w such that if I take the Fourier transform of it, that looks sparse in the frequency domain. And even another interesting aspect of this problem is that this bias changes with the depth of the network. To give actually like the formal definition, what happens with two layers, with this one convolution layer and one fully connected layer, is that we end up solving an optimization problem, which is maximizing the margin subject to an L1 penalty on the frequency components of beta. So beta is the final linear predictor we are learning. Take the Fourier transform of beta and take an L1 penalty on the absolute values, and that's the penalty we are minimizing implicitly using gradient descent here. Okay. So what happens for multiple layers? Multiple layers, you can show that what it effectively ends up optimizing a problem, which is minimizing the LP penalty for p less than 1. So for p less than 1, this optimization problem here is non-convex, so we cannot show that gradient descent actually converges to the global minimizer of this problem. But rather, what we end up showing is that for larger and larger networks, like gradient descent converges to some stationary point of this optimization problem. So the LP penalty is like for p less than 1 is actually a closer approximation of sparsity, except that it's non-convex, so it's often hard to solve in the worst case. So what does it look like in practice? In a very toy example, again, none of these are real examples. In a very toy example, we can see that with two layers, the solution learned by a convolutional network starts looking like a sine wave, which is like a one frequency component. And with higher layers, it starts looking more and more like a sine wave. So in some sense, it's promoting sparsity in the frequency domain. And this in comparison to fully connected networks, where it just fits the signal wherever possible and learns more or less a uniform sparsity, uniformly low norm weights. So why do we get these very different answers? So if I have a new architecture, how do I come up with what is the bias in that architecture? Do I just go through this entire process again? So to partially alleviate that, we kind of decomposed it into two parts. One is we can start thinking about a larger class of model classes, which is homogeneous linear models, so you can think of these are all functions which are linear functions of X, but where the mapping from the parameters to the linear predictor is a homogeneous function. By homogeneous function, you can just think of as like if I scale the parameter by alpha, the final predictor gets scaled by some scalar times the predictor with W. Okay, so that's the definition of homogeneous function. For this broad class, and in particular, fully connected networks, convolutional networks, and even like other forms of linear networks, many other standard forms of linear network can be posed in this way. And for all such networks or all such function classes, you can again show a result, again with many assumptions, that gradient descent implicitly does something to minimize the Euclidean norm of the parameters. So in the parameter space, it's minimizing the L2 norm subject to margin constraint. It's not exactly minimizing because what we show is like it converges to a stationary point of this problem. Again, this problem could be non-convex because the constraints here could be non-convex in the parameters itself. Okay. So this is the bias we can show that gradient descent has for this family of functions. And actually, in a follow-up work, we can extend it to general homogeneous functions, not just homogeneous linear function. And that's a follow-up work and kind of work in progress too, in some sense. So what does it mean? So I have characterized the gradient descent on homogeneous linear models, the bias of gradient descent in the parameter space. So
what did you say about non-linear homogeneous?
So for non-linear homogeneous functions, we can show a similar result, but with an extra additional assumption, which I won't be specifying. Yeah. Right. I'll specify the assumptions used for these theorems in a couple of slides. But for non-homogeneous networks, there is an additional assumption we make. Right. Okay. When I say I characterize the inductive bias, this is essentially I'm like giving a characterization of what kind of solutions gradient descent can converge to. So this is one aspect of the inductive bias from the optimization perspective. Like, but it's not like, of course, completely characterizing what is exact solution. Okay. So now we have bias in the parameter space. Now we can look at what this means in the prediction space. And this can be done as a separate component. Now we can start looking at what does minimizing an L2 norm in the parameters mean in the class of predictions. And that complexity measure can be essentially written as like how much of an L2 norm, what is the minimum L2 norm solution? Representation of a function in through this particular network, okay, and so now we can start characterizing what this complexity measure in the prediction looks like for different architectures. In particular, by choosing different architectures, we can implicitly or we can drive different biases on the final prediction class we are choosing. So even though we are using gradient descent and gradient descent on any of these architectures give us the same bias in the parameter space. By choosing different architectures, we get different biases in the prediction space. In particular, by choosing convolutional networks, we get a bias of sparsity in the frequency domain. And if I have two-layer linear network, but with multiple outputs. So this is like the matrix factorization setting. In this case, you can show that, so it's learning a matrix of linear predictor, and here you can show that this complexity measure is essentially a nuclear norm. And another follow-up work, which Nati is super excited about with students and another faculty at TTI, is where if I have like one, like learning a mapping from scalar to scalar with an infinite width fully connected network. So in this case, minimizing the L2 norm corresponds to minimizing essentially like the total variation of the derivative of the function class. So you can, so such networks can represent any scalar to scalar function, like any continuous scalar to scalar function. And in this case, you can give a characterization of what kind of functions can be represented with networks with small norm. And you can talk to Nati about it. He'll talk for 2 days about it. He's super excited. Anyways, so the takeaway point is like the geometry of the parameters influence the form of the implicit inductive bias. And specifically, the choice of architecture design interacts very nicely with the form of the implicit bias we use. Okay, so now to give some theorem details. So we have been only looking at separable data sets where there is a clear linear separating hyperplane and looking at exponential laws, minimizing exponential laws using gradient descent. And the specific question we have, our work focuses on is like, which classifier does gradient descent on this problem converge to? There are many related questions which we don't really address in our work and make it more of an assumption, which is like in many of these models, optimization objective is indeed non-convex. So it's not obvious that, it's not a priori clear that gradient descent will converge to a global minimizer. And so this is a related optimization question. And moreover, for exponential type losses, like as we said, like the gradient descent iterates diverge in norm. But we have been trying to characterize the direction. And there is no a priori guarantee that like the direction should converge to begin with. And this is another thing which we can potentially prove more precisely. And for linear networks, it has been proven. Fully connected linear networks, it has been proven. But more generally, in our theorems, we make these as assumptions. Specifically, we assume that the loss converges to zero, the direction of the iterates converge, and the gradients converge in direction. And under these assumptions, we show which specific classifier does gradient descent converge to. Okay, so just to summarize the results we had for implicit bias from gradient descent, we first showed, I mean, although we didn't go over this result, many of the earlier work alluded to it, that minimizing underdetermined least squares with gradient descent leads to minimum Euclidean norm solution. For matrix completion kind of problems, we got minimum, sometimes we get minimum nuclear norm solution, which can be thought of as minimizing the Euclidean norm in the factors. For logistic regression, we get something like minimizing the Euclidean norm subject to margin constraints. And for more generally linear networks, we again get minimizing the Euclidean norm and parameter. So overall, there seems to be a bias towards minimizing the Euclidean norm of the parameters and for gradient descent. We want to see if there is a connection to the optimization bias to optimization geometry. So I'll make precise what optimization geometry is in a bit, but that is like our connecting work for the next last part of the talk. Okay. So are there any questions for the first part of the talk? All right. Okay. So this is another of our work where we try to form a connection between optimization bias and optimization geometry. So to see what optimization geometry is, so let's look at gradient descent update. So this update formula is pretty much known to everyone. But one of the ways of thinking about this update is essentially, you can think of taking a step in the negative gradient direction, where the step length is penalized by, step length measured in Euclidean norm is penalized somehow. So this is one way to derive at the same update equation we have for gradient descent. So you can think of finding a step which has most correlation with the negative gradient, but at the same time close to the current estimate. And the reason this is interesting is like negative gradient is a local approximation of the loss function. Because it's a local approximation, we want to stay close to where we started. So in some sense, it's a trading off the two objectives. And from this form of the objective, we can easily see many generalization of this algorithm. Specifically, you can think of steepest descent in general norms, which is essentially doing the same procedure, but penalizing the step length in some other norm, non-Euclidean norm specifically. Okay, that leads, and specific, if the non-Euclidean norm is L1 norm, this leads to a form of coordinate descent. And you can also think of mirror descent as a formulation of, in this framework, where the penalty to moving from the current point is measured in terms of a Bregman divergence. I won't define what Bregman divergence is. It is just another measure on another way to measure closeness between two points. It's not a norm exactly, which is why it doesn't fall under the steepest descent category. Okay, so for all these cases, like the steepest descent, the norm of the steepest descent or the Brinkmann divergence corresponding to the mirror descent, essentially defines the geometry in which I'm making the updates. And we want to see if there is a general relation between optimization bias and the optimization geometry. So you want to see what these algorithms, so far I've been focusing on what gradient descent does for different problems. Now we want to see, take a problem and see what different algorithms do for the same problem. And want to somehow relate between the optimization bias and the optimization geometry. So first let's look at optimization bias in steepest descent. So this is essentially like a gradient descent except that the step length is penalized in a different norm. So here, by generalizing an earlier analysis, we can show that the solution we converge to is still a max margin solution except that it's now max margin with respect to the norm of the steepest descent update. So in particular for L1 norm, it corresponds to boosting or coordinate descent, in which case you get an L1 max margin solution. And if I use some other norm, you end up with some other max margin solution. So there is a very clean connection between the geometry of the updates and the solution you converge to in exponential loss cases. Right? And what about squared loss? So we didn't talk much about squared loss after our initial matrix completion problem. But if you think of squared loss, like I said, in gradient descent, if I solve an underdetermined least squares problem, you get to a solution which minimizes the L2 norm. So a natural extension would be that we'll expect something which will minimize the norm of the steepest descent from the initialization. So for now, let's just think of initialization as zero in all these problems. Okay. So we expect something which minimizes the norm of norm with respect to the steepest descent norm, but it doesn't happen to be true. Like in matrix completion, like where we saw that the step size does play an important role. Even here, we see that with different step sizes, we get to different solutions. And even more importantly, even in this limit of step size going to zero and initialization being exactly zero, the expected characterization does not hold for steepest descent. Okay? So in some sense, what the takeaway is that like it definitely, like, the optimization geometry influences the optimization bias, but the nature of the bias itself depends on the nature of loss function. In particular, for exponential loss functions or classification losses, we have an infinite arc length which the optimization algorithm takes it in. Like compared to where we start, where we end up is like infinite distance away. And as a result, like you get characterizations which are independent of initialization and step size. Whereas in squared loss settings, this is much more of a this requires a much more delicate analysis. So, and now what about like mirror descent? So here we get a very different flavor of results too. So first for squared loss, we do get a clean characterization. We can show that with appropriate initialization, the solution we converge to is actually something which is minimizing the mirror descent potential. Okay, so mirror descent is defined with respect to some potential function psi. For example, if you want to think of exponentiated gradient descent as a mirror descent, which is the most common form mirror descent is used, the potential function psi is an entropy function. And if you want to think of gradient descent as a mirror descent, the potential function psi is like the L2 norm square. Okay? So with appropriate initialization, we can show that mirror descent converges to something which minimizes the potential function. But for in particular, for exponentiated gradient descent, you can show that it converges to a maximum entropy solution. That's a corollary of this result. But what about exponential loss? So here, we again expect to get something like a max margin solution which minimizes the potential function, right? But if we, that's an immediate thought we have. But if we stare at this equation a bit more, we see that like when psi is non-homogeneous, when psi is not a norm, like in gradient descent or steepest descent. So this margin, so fixing this optimization problem is essentially fixing the margin to be one and minimizing the potential function, right? When the potential function is not homogeneous, a margin of one is not special. Like, why should margin of one be special, any more special than margin of two or three, right? Whereas if psi was homogeneous, they're all equivalent up to scalings, right? So the directions will all be the same. Whereas if it's not, it's gonna give you a very different solution. So this particular formulation itself is nothing special. So we don't expect to converge to this solution, and we don't converge to the solution. So a part of work in progress, that's why I'm not stating it as a formal result, is that in some cases refer to some potential functions, mirror descent converges to something we call as the limit of the margin path. So you can take this optimization objective, and instead of making the margin 1, you can make the margin gamma, and look at what is the solution, what is the direction in which I converge as gamma goes to infinity, right? If it converges at all. So that's why it's still work in progress. We have to formalize under what condition this converges, and if it converges, does gradient descent also converge to the same limit? Or sorry, mirror descent also converge to the same limit? So those are the aspects which we still haven't figured out. Okay, so this gives us a natural way to think about these problems. So we have, let's say for general loss functions, like I'll conclude with this slide. So for general loss functions, we can think of the optimization path as like what the optimization algorithm takes, which is typically like some local search algorithm. Many local search algorithms can be written as something which is moving in the gradient direction by penalizing some distance to the to the current point. And you can define the margin path as as the solution where I'm explicitly minimizing some complexity measure with respect to initialization, subject to margin constraints. And as I require more and more margin, I'm making this constraint weaker and weaker. You can also relate these two. So in all our results, we have essentially related these two paths. So in all our steepest descent result, linear network result, we can show that this margin path has a unique solution, which is our max margin solution, whatever I've been stating. And we have been trying to relate when optimization converges to a margin path, the limit of the margin path. Okay. And in all the results we stated, we also connect these two, we can also show a connection between these two paths to what we call as regularization path, which is the path obtained by explicitly putting the complexity measure as a regularization. Okay? So we have these three quantities, which are all like, which all have some parameters going to infinity, and optimization path is the limit of, it's the final convergence point. For margin path, it's like as margin goes to infinity, and the regularization path is as regularization goes to zero. And we want, and in all the current result, we have shown that in these limits, the three paths coincide up to stationarity conditions and so on. But more generally, we can start asking the question for non-homogeneous models or homogeneous non-linear models, like even for neural networks, is there a connection between these three paths? And that's a natural question we are further working on. There are some preliminary results in an upcoming paper, but it is far from being completely worked out for general non-homogeneous models. So as to conclude, like I hope we have convinced you enough that the role of optimization in machine learning extends beyond reaching a global minimum. And in overparameterized models, like the inductive bias of learning not only comes from the model constraints, but primarily from the optimization algorithm used. And in our work, we have used linear models and linear networks as simple and intuitive starting points where we observe many interesting phenomena, which are broad concepts that can be extended. One is about the interaction between parameter geometry and the prediction geometry, like decomposing it as like what happens in the parameter space versus prediction space. The other is relating the optimization geometry to the nature of optimization bias. And another thing which came out of this line of work is like how different family of losses, specifically squared loss-like losses used in regression versus exponential tail losses used in classification behavior. And I'll again like to thank my collaborators, and I'll take any questions you have. Thank you. So if they're not strictly separable in, sorry? No. So if they're not completely separable, as far as I know, there are, we don't know the exact answer. But if they're non-strictly separable, so if there are points which lie in the decision boundary, so then Mathis's result essentially says that you still get convergence of the population loss. as gradient descent, convergence of the population loss to the margin, to the loss of the max margin solution as gradient descent proceeds. But I don't know of the other results which are in this, on that topic, yeah.
So for some of your results on like layer, convolutional layers where you get sparsity of the Fourier domain, mm-hmm. So it seems like in, you know, in some settings when you, you know, figure out what filters you're learning in the bottom layer, they're usually like Gabor filters, they have some sort of localization problems.
Right.
So it seems a bit surprising that you get something which is sinusoidal and not localized in the spatial domain.
Oh, so it... So Gabor, even Gabor filters, so if you look at it in frequency domain, it will be like sparse components, right?
Yep.
So that is essentially picking out certain frequency. And all these Gabor filters and stuff, they also essentially pick out high frequency components. Because in an image, like the most things we learn about are essentially high frequency. And a sinusoidal kind of wave is essentially looking for patterns which are repeating across the image. And so it does seem to do similar thing.
But it's repeating everywhere as opposed to just like localizing.
Isn't there an explanation that your convolution is not really convolution? It's
funny.
It's
what?
Yeah, so it's
so
you're not using the spatial.
Oh,
it is a convolution.
It is
a convolution, but it's not. It's not a funny convolution.
It is a. So yeah, you can think of, like, I use one dimension, right? So if you actually look at it in two dimension, it'll look like bumps, which is essentially looking for repeating patterns, which are as frequency components, right? And in this case, it's particularly looking for one particular frequency. The sinusoid happens to be looking for one particular frequency, right?
Whereas
I see.
What you would have usually right. is limit the width in the signal of the convolution. And I think it's a good guess that if you do that, you get sparsity in some kind of wavelet limit.
Yeah, exactly.
We weren't able to to get there or identify which wavelet domain.
Okay, so
but,
if there aren't any more questions, let's take further questions offline, and thank Suriya again.
Okay, thank you.